Good evening, everyone, and welcome to eSpartacus's today's live interview session. My name is Shomo Shaha, and I am the founder of eSpartacus and the organizer of today's interview session. Today we have organized the 28th session of our interview series, and our theme is India Yesterday and Today. In our last interview session, we had Professor Radhakanta Barik with us. His episode has been uploaded in the eSpartacus YouTube channel. So the ones who couldn't watch the entire episode live, they could go to our YouTube channel and watch it. The link for it has been provided in our Facebook page. Today we have with us Professor Tanveer Arshad, who is an assistant professor of political science in Presidency University, Kolkata. Today he is going to speak on the subject of Afghanistan, Taliban, and India. Professor Arshad has done his PhD from Siliguri's University of North Bengal on India-Pakistan relation and the role of United Nations. His research interests include Indian foreign policy with specific focus on South Asia and China. Apart from this, he has also worked as a former SUSI fellow in the University of Massachusetts in USA. He has published various articles in many recognized journals, some of which include Sino-Indian Border Dispute, an analysis of the territorial dispute in the Himalayas, in the Indian Journal of Law and Justice, Empowering Women Through SHG and Microfinance, an Inclusive Approach, in the edited book of Women Empowerment in India, Opportunities and Challenges, Human Rights in Azad Kashmir, A Case of Denial and Deprivation, in the edited book of Theory and Practice of Human Rights, The Indian Context, and many other such publications he has to his name. We are extremely grateful to Professor Arshad for joining with us today. We welcome him to our today's session.
Thank you, Shomo. It's a great honor for me to be a part of this show. And I'm really thankful to you and Professor Basu, Pradeep Basu, sir, for inviting me for today's session. And I'm looking forward that, let's hope I do justice to the session and your eSpartacus.
Absolutely, sir. For conducting Professor Arshad's interview, we have with us Professor Pradeep Basu of Presidency University, Kolkata, who also teaches in the Department of Political Science. Professor, before teaching in Presidency University, Professor Basu has worked for a long time in the Scottish Church College of Calcutta, again in the Department of Political Science. He has done his PhD from Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Calcutta. And his research interests include post-colonial studies and Naxalite movement, on which he has written various books and edited various books as well. Therefore, without wasting any more time, we will directly move on to Professor Pradeep Basu so that he may start the interview session with us.
Thank you, Shomo Shaha, the organizer of eSpartacus, and also Aurithya Roy Bormon, the editor of eSpartacus. And I also welcome, I thank my colleague, my dearest colleague, Dr. Tanveer Arshad. I am grateful to him that keeping me waiting for several months, he has finally agreed to waste his time talking to me, but it will not be a waste for the audience. I just want to mention that this is a series. Actually, first 25 sessions were held under the theme West Bengal Politics Today. There were guests like Moidul Islam, Sanjeev Mukherjee, Debi Chatterjee, Shobhanlal Dattagupta, Pranab Kanti Basu, Kollan Kumar Das, Rajarshi Dasgupta, Himadri Chatterjee, Bula Bhadra, Nibedita Saha, Priyanka Mathur, Porimal Ghosh, Samir Kumar Das, Kunal Chattopadhyay, Pratim Basu, Shatabdi Das, Ayon Guho, Viraj Lakhi Ghosh, Jawahar Sarkar, Pralankar Bhattacharya, Arnob Saha, Alok Das, Ishita Sur, and Samrat Sengupta. Then we broadened our theme into India yesterday and today. Under this theme, the first speaker was Sujoy Ghosh, and then there was Radhakanto Barik from Indian Institute of Public Administration, Delhi. And today, session number 28, we have Professor Tanveer Arshad. Today, our sub-theme today is Afghanistan, Taliban, and India. Just to look back for a little while, from 79 to 89, there was the Soviet-backed regime in Afghanistan. From 1996 to 2001, there was the first Taliban regime, then Al-Qaeda, then the 9/11. It's a belief that Al-Qaeda and Laden, Osama bin Laden, they lived underground with the secret support of the Taliban's in Afghanistan. And from 2001 to 2021, for 20 years, Afghanistan was under US military occupation. Now, my first question to Dr. Arshad, to Tanveer, is that what made the US withdraw its troops? What were the goals of sending the US military forces? Were the goals fulfilled, or they left Afghanistan with dreams, objectives, keeping unfulfilled? Please explain, please throw some light.
I mean, first of all, thank you so much, sir, for such an introduction, which I don't think I deserve, actually. But, you know, just coming to your questions directly, let me just make one thing very clear. And I believe those who are an avid reader of world politics, specifically those who actually are aware about American politics particularly, you know, they'll agree to the point which I'm making, that the decision which President Biden took to pull off the US-led allied forces from Afghanistan was something which was not a surprise, first of all. It was very much predictable. It was very much inevitable. But it was a miscalculated move, if I can say so. You know, before looking into the thing that what led the American-led allied forces pull off or pull out from Afghanistan, I think we should make one thing very clear in our mind, that Americans never went to Afghanistan for nation building. Be it in 1980s, be it in Libya, be it in Vietnam, be it in Iraq, and be it in 2020 Afghanistan, Americans or American foreign policy, they never prioritize this. It's an example of a pure form of classical realism, you know, where they just prioritize their national interest. Now, the national objective was very clear. Be it in the 80s, late 80s, or be it in 2021. Back then, it was containment of communism. They knew very well that whatever be, we have to anyhow contain the rise and the spread of Soviet. We all know it's well documented, you know, not even a classified one. It's well documented that the Taliban, the Mujahideens, they were actually the brainchild and sponsored, you know, actors of CIA and ISI. Now in 2021, come to the picture in 2021, it was very clear that Americans were trying to put themselves in Afghanistan just to settle their score, because it was after 9/11, Americans thought that, you know, it's high time that we should go out there. We should take their fight was directly with Al-Qaeda. And that's what President Biden and even Secretary of State Blinken has openly declared, you know. So the first point, that America's coming out from Afghanistan was a bolt of out of a blue or a surprising thing, was not. I beg to differ this. It was very much predictable and inevitable. You know, if you go a little bit back, I mean, you can find out that this narrative of a negotiated withdrawal, which the Americans are right now claiming, it basically started much back when Obama, President POTUS Obama, came up with a narrative of what he called as the idea of good Taliban and bad Taliban, you know. So it was very clear that US was planning back for a negotiated withdrawal of the American troops out of Afghanistan, which unfortunately failed miserably, the idea of good Taliban and bad Taliban. So, I mean, Biden's decision to pull out was hardly a surprise. Rather, as I told you, it was a miscalculated move. Why? I'll tell you. Number one is, let's understand the fact that why and when the negotiation started. I mean, I have told you about Obama. But if you also move a little bit back, just previous year, in 2020, when the Doha round of talks were being initiated, the Americans were pretty convinced that a new generation of Taliban has come into the picture. They are far more reasonable. They have changed outlook. They are not like the early generation of Taliban. And, you know, so they thought that through the Doha peace talk, the Americans could find a negotiated way out from Afghanistan. Now, when Biden came into the picture in early 2021, he made the phenomena as very obvious. Why? Because back when Obama was the president of the United States, Biden was serving as the vice president or to Barack Obama. Now, back then also, he always insisted that a war should always be limited to the mission. If you remember, when President Obama, the so-called surge, was planning to authorize to deploy more and more troops in Afghanistan, Biden was the one to oppose the decision. So Biden's announcement was very much expected. Even his associate, the Secretary of State, as I was telling you, he made it very clear that our fight is with Al-Qaeda and not Taliban. And the mission is to deal with the folk who actually was the brainchild behind 9/11. We have succeeded in our mission. Whether they have succeeded or not, I'll come to that thing. Second cause, or second reason, if I may say, the reason why we can actually predict, or it was very much not a surprise, the withdrawal of American forces. If we try to look at it from a statistical point of view, you know, 20 years of war, from Bush to Biden, an investment of around more than $3 trillion, around more than 8 lakh of death, casualties, displacement, and multiple anti-war, you know, movements and in different platforms and homeland. So I believe Biden, being a pacifist, had to make the call for an end game. I would refer to a poll survey which was conducted by Harris and Chicago Council, where they said that when Biden was hinting that they want to withdraw the forces from Afghanistan, you know, almost 70% or more than 70% of Americans supported Biden's withdrawal. So it was very clear that Biden is going to pull off its troops from Afghanistan. Last but not the least, if I may also say that, you know, I don't know whether it's known to everyone or not, that after President Dwight Eisenhower, Biden is the only one to have a child serve in an active conflict. Bo Biden, he served in Iraq as a member of the Delaware Army National Guard, you know, and the president speculated that the toxins, which were basically the military burn pits that were used to dispose the waste, that might have caused the reason for the cancer of Bo Biden. And because of which, in one of a memoir by Richard Holbrooke, who was a special envoy to Afghanistan, Biden made it very clear. Biden specifically said that I'm not sending my boys back there to risk his life on or for Afghan women rights. That's not what they are meant for. So, you know, Americans' withdrawal, as I was telling you, was very much predictable. What is most shocking and surprising to me, if you ask me, was the speed of the Taliban's advance. I mean, that was really not predictable.
We are coming to that. But before, about this paradox that when USA sent troops to Afghanistan 20 years back, they declared two objectives. One was the fighting out of the Al-Qaeda, the terrorists, the war on terror. That was announced by George Bush. And the second one was bringing back democracy to Afghanistan. But now Biden has announced that whether the Afghans will choose a democracy or not, what kind of political system they will choose, that is absolutely their choice. And we have nothing to do about that. It is their responsibility. So we are getting back. So there is a shift in their announcement regarding the goals. And you see, Biden has said that we have trained 3 lakhs of Afghan soldiers and equip them with latest modern weapons. It is their responsibility. And the last president, this Ashraf Ghani, he fled Afghanistan. It was their responsibility to protect Afghan democracy from the hands of the Taliban's. Now, can you please explain why these 3 lakhs of Afghan soldiers, they surrendered so quickly, and only 75,000 Talibans, they won victory. One village after another village, one city after another city, so quickly. At 10th April, the announcement was made by the American government. And within so little time, the Afghan soldiers surrendered, and Talibans, in a short while, they succeeded. How will you explain it, please?
I mean, so what President Biden is saying continuously in almost all the press conferences, that we have trained a well-equipped around 3 lakh Afghan soldiers to counter the rise of Taliban. when the US retreats back, you know, just look at the videos of those. Some of the videos are viral, first of all. Just look at the videos. There are multiple reasons, you know, you can. First of all is that these recruits, these so-called 3 lakh soldiers or troops of Afghan, you know, they have no match with the one who trained them. So they were being trained by the best armies of the world, US armed forces. That too at a flag end. And if you are aware about how the US armed forces actually work, they work in coordination with the air forces, and they are well specialized soldiers. They spend months and years in field, and finally they live up to the perfect expectation. And that is why Taliban was unable to rise when the US soldiers were there. But these so-called strong government forces, 3 lakh, okay, those were basically, I mean, completely immature when the Taliban came in. It made two things very clear. Number one is that the forces had taken things for granted. Afghan government, be it Ghani, be it Abdullah Abdullah, or be it Karzai, they took things for granted. And when the moment was there to train them, and when the moment was there to have a strong military base to protect the to the territory, they actually ignored it. The morale of the armies were really down. I was just going through some of the reports by the New York Times. It showed that the armies were not even paid for months. No artilleries, no food supply, no salary, a broken morale, no government interference. And what can you expect? So when the Taliban came back, just 80,000 men with high boost, high morale, having a faith that, okay, if I fight in a war, I'll die as a martyr and I'll go to heaven. You know, they just crumbled down like a house of cards. It was like a dominoes falling one after another. Now, why the Taliban? It was so easy for the Taliban to take over it. I would like to rather explain it in a theoretical way. So, you know, Robert Chauhan, he basically says that, he's a scholar of professor of international relations, and he basically calls, he's famous for his theory, which is known as the hegemonic stability theory, which basically he argues that in any international system, or the stability is likely to retain as long as a hegemon or a power is controlling it. The moment the power shift, the moment the power collapse, it creates a power vacuum. And as a result, the stability of the system breaks down. For Afghanistan, United States of America was the sole stabilizer of the system. And the moment Biden made the announcement that we are ready to withdraw, we are ready to bring out our forces, you know, Taliban forces captured and occupied Afghanistan. Within few days, Kandahar, Zafarabad, Herat, you know, Bamiyan, and finally Kabul. It went like what I was talking about, dominoes, house of cards. Although, you know, some has to also blame on the lack of time of transition that was given due to this sudden miscalculated announcement. But two things were very clear, as I was telling you. Number one is the Americans were the sole reason why Taliban and their sympathizers were not ready to rise up. And second was the zero government presence in Afghanistan. Neither Ghani nor Karzai, they sort of maximizing their presence. You know, and that is why the Afghan soldiers who were being trained by the US, so-called trained by the US forces, they couldn't sustain longer. The forces abandoned their post. They had a broken morale. There was no air support. There was no strategic, well-planned, standard operative protocol. It was mere a rule of thumb that was working. Moreover, you know, I would also like to bring in a second factor to this one. I would also like to view the sudden surge of Afghanistan from a different angle, if allowed. I mean, like, you know, for that, it's necessary to move a little bit back in the history and try to understand during the post-communist Afghanistan or after the post-communist Afghanistan, when Afghanistan got divided on or along the ethnic lines and the rise of this Pashtun-dominated Talibans, which were supported by CIA and ISI, you know, in the year 1996, in Kandahar, there's a holy shrine and it's regarded as the holiest city in Afghanistan. The reason is, in that shrine, there is supposedly the cloak which was worn by Prophet Muhammad is kept out there. In the year 1996, I don't remember the date, Mullah Umar, who by then was very famous leader of Taliban and had gained a lot of popularity, he appeared on the roof of the mosque, hold the cloak in his hand and pronounce himself as Amirul Mumin, which means the commander of the faithful. You know, this incident basically is still now in the mind of the Taliban warriors, Taliban fighters. They still believe that they are fighting for the cause on the, that they're basically representing the armies of Allah. And whatever they do, if they die as a martyr, they'll reach to heaven. So I hope you're getting my point. At one point of time, we have a weak, non-trained, amateur, broken morale, 3 lakhs of armies, which immediately after listening that the US had withdrawn, has nothing to do. Either they surrender or they die. So the only thing they thought that we will surrender because, you know, we have been seeing videos. They remember what happened back in 1996 when Taliban first emerged. How can you forget the hanging of Najibullah, the last communist leader? He was being dragged off. He was hanged in front of everyone. Those who were against anti-Talibanis, they were being brutally stoned, put into death. So that, I mean that was pretty obvious. The soldier disarming themselves. And you know, that was the catalyst factor which was basically helping Taliban or the Talibani forces to grab their hold in so-called the major cities and the what you call of Afghanistan after the US led.
Many people, especially in the TV shows, I was observing, watching some channels. Some people were claiming that there was a considerable local support by the local people in Afghanistan, that made it easy for the Talibans to capture power so quickly. Do you think that the local people, after the experience of first Taliban regime from 1996 to 2001, they were ready to accept the second Taliban regime because they were so much disgusted with the American rule, the foreign rule. They were not happy with the American military presence, military occupation. So that is one reason. This was the view of some commentators. What is your take about this comment?
I'm absolutely sorry. I think I missed your first question. So I, if you don't mind, sir, I'm really sorry. If you can just put one question, I'm sorry. In the last set of questions, I think you gave, this question was there, but somehow I missed it. Okay, yes. Coming to this one, you know, people in Afghanistan, they were dissatisfied not only against, not only because of the rule by a foreign ruler. They were rather dissatisfied because they thought that the government which was there in Kabul, be it Karzai, be it Abdul Ghani, be it Ghani, Ashraf, they were basically, they have become corrupt. This corruption was evident in most of the district and among the people of Afghanistan. They thought that the only possible way by which they can seek any form of, you know, justice was if the government can take care of their basic demands. I mean, just look at the GDP and look at the ratios of, you know, human rights ratio, the ratio of, you know, deaths due to malnutrition, deaths due to female infanticides. You know, you'll see that after, or the opium trade. Afghanistan is regarded as the largest opium trader in the world. You know, even after Americans were there, the level of opium trade, illicit opium trade, the level of human rights, the level of, female infanticides, these cases, except in some of the major districts, if you look into the other areas, they were horrible. So people in Afghanistan, they had no way right around. I mean, like, either they have, and the reason why they supported Taliban is because, if you remember, if you can recall some of the videos of Kabul and the airports and the streets when the Taliban attacked, people were running. You know, if you notice carefully, it was not only the women who were running, it was the male people who was running also. Why? Because they were not afraid of Taliban, because they were afraid of the Sharia law which Taliban was implementing. Because they knew very well that if you go against Taliban, either you have to be brave like the Panjshir people, Ahmad Shah Massoud, Ahmad Massoud and others. If you can't, then you'll be stoned to death. You'll be killed brutally. So their options were very limited. Number one, they had a corrupt government. Number two, no government presence. Number three, Taliban at the crossroads, Taliban knocking their door, telling you have either two choices, support us or die in front of everyone. And number five, the one who were the protectors, so-called protectors, the US-led allied forces, they had withdrawn themselves. Unfortunately, people around the globe are talking about the miseries of people, of so-called miseries or challenges for democracy and the future of democracy. You know, I think what we need to discuss, we need to talk, we need to be concerned about are the common people, common tribal people of Taliban's. What are their status? The minorities of Taliban, because they had practically no other options. And right now, unfortunately, they are again being blamed. They have been blamed because they have been said that you are the one who supported the influx of Taliban. But let's look the thing other way around. What choices they did have? They have no other choices. If I'm being lynched by someone right now, tomorrow, when I go out from my house, just because to prove some identity, what option do I have in my hand? I have nothing. That is what it's happening in Afghanistan, unfortunately, right now. So it's wrong, I think, to presume. It's wrong, I think. I disagree to agree with the viewpoints that they got local support. Yes, it was inevitable. The supports of the local, because they had no other choices. They had no other choices.
You see, there are different ethnic groups like Hazara, Uzbek,
Tajiks,
Baluch, and the largest group perhaps is the Pashtuns.
Pashtun, yes.
So, do you think to all these ethnic communities, Taliban being largely represented by the Pashtun will be acceptable?
Taliban being the largest ethnic group in Afghanistan.
Pashtun.
Sorry, Pashtuns being the largest ethnic group of Afghanistan, will they be accepted?
To the sure. other ethnic communities.
Okay. I got your point. So first of all, see, the way Taliban is reclaiming back their territory and identity in Afghanistan, they're not doing it in a peaceful way. They're not doing it in a democratic way. They are completely anti-democrat. They believe in non-Western idea. They are completely non-democratic in the way they understand holding the power. And for them, controlling or holding a property comes from the barrel of the gun. Pashtuns being the largest ethnic community in Afghanistan, supported and backed by, I mean, the sympathizers, which I'm soon some of the classified documents of United States will come up and will come into the picture. We'll see that it's been backed right now by a lot of big players. Okay. Unfortunately, after the Tajiks, you know, there's no one who can actually resist the rise or influx of the Pashtuns. And that is why, de facto, they are getting hold of the so-called territories. The other minorities which you are talking about are very nominal in number. Pashtuns are Deobandis am I audible, sir? Yes, Pashtuns are Deobandis. So they were being trained. I mean, like, just if you look into the history during 80s, trained in as a militant outfit in the lands of Pakistan and, you know, getting a lot of logistical supports, military supports from big players of the region. So obviously, it's a very clear fact that what Mao said, that power comes from the barrel of the gun. So it's because they are holding the gun in their hand and they believe in a non-democratic idea of holding and claiming their identity, claiming their power. That is why they are dominating the entire scenario right now. However, although there is an anti-Talibani surge which is being observed right now, and son of Ahmad Shah Massoud, who was regarded as the lion of Panjshir. Apparently, if you know that Panjshir is the only place right now which has been unable to be occupied by the Taliban, and it's because of the geographical location of Panjshir. So the Panjshir, it's an Arabic word which means five lion. So Ahmad Shah Durrani, during his reign, five leaders, tribal warlords, they basically created. So his son, Ahmad Shah Massoud's son, who was regarded as the lion of Panjshir, his son right now, and his anti-Talibani, Northern Alliance, his forces, they have been able to occupy three districts, which is a very remarkable development. Pule Hazar, Desala and Banu, these are the three districts which has been occupied, which has been somehow been controlled by the Northern Alliance. So, you know, time will tell that whether the Tajiks, okay, who are the major in Panjshir region, whether they'll be able to contain or whether they can withstand or resist the rise of Taliban or not. But I have a very pessimist idea. I don't think so. I mean, like, whether it's actually possible. I mean, anyways, yes.
The former Vice President Saleh is there.
Yeah.
He is one of the leaders. Yes.
He's one of the leaders of Northern Alliance.
Yes. I heard that the grandson and the granddaughter of Simant Gandhi, you know Simant Gandhi from Northwest Frontier Province, these people, these two people, they came in the TV, television, and they were saying that this is not what Islam teaches us. And I was talking to a girl, she had been married to a Muslim boy. She has done research over Muslim women in Bombay and Kolkata, a comparative study. For several years, she has been working. She was telling me that the Taliban are announcing that they are going to follow Sharia, but actually they are interpreting it in their own way, because the torture, the undemocratic measures, the oppression perpetrated upon the Afghan women, and also upon the opposition voices, which are being suppressed. These two things, women's liberty, women's freedom, and secondly, right to criticize the ruling power, these two are totally suppressed, but this is not what is prescribed by Islam. So from the TV interview and from this lady, this researcher lady, I learned about this. Now, what is your understanding about this?
Okay, now a few things needs to be made very clear that, you know, in Islam, basically, the followers of Islam believe and follows whatever is written in the holy verse of the Holy Quran. Sharia is basically considered as the, say when Prophet Muhammad, his daily practices, his daily customs, his daily rituals, it was mentioned in Sharia. And it's what the Taliban wants to apply and wants to, you know, make the future Afghanistan rule like, using Sharia as the law of land. Now see, when you try to reinterpret an interpreted thought, misunderstanding, confusions is bound to emerge. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an illiterate person. He never wrote the Holy Quran. Rather, he used to basically deliver the verses of Quran and his followers used to note them down. Now that basically much late was being thought that it is time to reproduce it, and as a result of which copies were being reproduced, because let's remember at that point of time, back then we did not have printing. I mean, like, so eventually with the rise of modern era, you know, modern age, it started getting reprinted, and the more it got, started getting reprinted, author tried to add new essence to it. And you know, the Sharia, what the Afghan is right now trying to interpret, the Sharia, the what the Afghan is trying to use as the law of land to control Afghanistan, is way more different, is completely, I mean, if I may say, fabricated in the way which we as a general philosophers or followers of Islam understand. I mean, if time permits, if I can just give some examples of it. I mean, one of my friend, he's working in the Indonesian Islamic University. He's the dean out there. So he says, I was calling him to know much more detail about how Islam views women as, you know. So in one of the Quranic verses, it is basically argued that, you know, women are inferior to Islam. So it's basically considered, you know, it's al-nisa, which says that, which is assumed, which leads to an assumption that women is inferior to men in Islam. But, you know, if you look into a detailed analysis and try to understand the context in which this was being, this verse, al-nisa, is being commented. And if I may take the reference of, Wadud, a scholar, a feminist scholar, she basically says that this idea of inferiority, that men are the protectors and maintainers of women because Allah has preferred some of them over others because they support them, which clearly means that it does not only mean, by using the word some of them over other, does not mean, literally does not mean men. You know, the use of some in the verse, according to the scholar feminist, Wadu, basically believes bad. So obviously, it basically believes that in the human context, there are some bad elements. And when those bad elements try to become a protector or a maintainer, it is bound to create problem. Bad there does not is identifying women. Bad can also be men. So the misinterpretation, I just gave you one example. So this misinterpretation that Quran or Islam believes that women are inferior to men is wrong. Because like the men who are considered to be superior to women in some aspect, some women also excels over some men in many matters. So the definition, interpretation is not absolute, it's subjective. So what the Talibanis are doing right now in order to, say, let me tell you, let's talk it in another way. In the battle of Mahabharata, Arjun Shaktuki, Lord Krishna, who is an avatar of Lord Vishnu, when Arjun was saying that my morale is down, I can't fight, I can't see the, you know, human atrocities, I can't see the bloodshed. What did Arjun, what did his Shaktuki say? His chariot. Krishna clearly said that, see, you have got an opportunity to fight a war. If you will not fight this righteous war, you will fail in your duty. You will lose your reputation. Your door will not open to heaven. So if I use it, fabricate it, understand it without the context in which it was said, and try to implement it, I'll breed fundamentalism. I'll breed, you know, hatred. That is what it is. Another area where Islam says that can women be the head of the state? You know, one of the Quranic verses says that, you know, a hadith is said that those who are entrusted with the affair of the woman, you know, they can never retain prosperity. But please understand the context when this was said by, you know, Prophet Muhammad. It was basically said at a period of time in the Battle of Camel, you know, in which Aisha, wife of Prophet Muhammad, participated in it. And Abu Bakr, who basically wrote, narrated the hadith, who said that if women lead the war or women lead a country, it will collapse. He started the battle, commanded the army, retained with Bibi Aisha, and you know, that is enough proof to the fact that you have to understand the context in which it is seen. The Talibanis are basically, what they're planning to do is that they're basically fabricating the thing, they're using the literatures for serving their own interests to to make sure that an establishment of Islamic Republic is being created based on the principle of Sharia. Actually, if you look into the principle of Islam, you know, the largest country where Islam is there is Indonesia. Look at the terrorism, ratio of terrorism, ratio of women freedom out there. It's way better than any other country, be it Pakistan, be it Afghanistan, it's way better, be it Bangladesh even, where the recent fundamentalists are being basically growing up, the religious fanatics, religious fundamentalists are basically claiming it. So all depends on how you look into the problem, how you explain the context, how you explain the, you know, entire situation, the entire verses, and understand the context. Without context, a text becomes irrelevant, taught by you. I mean, like, this is what I've learned from you. So,
but we need not be totally frustrated, because very recently I have seen videos, lots of Afghan women with their hijab, burqa, but they are very courageous ladies. They are coming in front of the processions, demonstrating against the violence and torture of the Talibans. They are Muslim ladies, Muslim women, but they are dauntless, they are fearless, and they are demonstrating against torture. That has happened in Afghanistan very recently. Now, yes. Thank you very much for your brilliant analysis. Let us come to India. India has a small border with Afghanistan, to Kashmir, I think. And having relations with China, Pakistan, and Russia.
Sir, your voice just cracked. Can you just repeat it?
Yes. There is a small border between Afghanistan and India through Kashmir.
So Pakistan occupied Kashmir.
Yeah. And Afghanistan has border with Pakistan, long border, Turkmenistan, Iran,
Uzbekistan.
Now you see, India, China, Pakistan, and Russia, they have sympathy for the Talibans. Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, they are still watching. And what will be the repercussions? What will be the impact of the Taliban victory upon Indian foreign policy and Indian diplomacy?
Okay, specifically India, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, sir. I mean, like, you're absolutely correct.
I just want to add that Pakistan and China, India doesn't have a good relations with these two countries right now. But Russia and Iran, these two countries were good friends traditionally of India. And Uzbekistan or say Tajikistan, these countries, they don't have any bitter relation with India for a long time. So now, after this Taliban rise, China, Pakistan, and Russia taking sides, what will be the fate of India, Indian foreign policy, India's relations with her neighboring countries in this region? Please throw some light.
Sir, please remind me if I am missing something. I would first like to answer what will be the response of India And I think the second question you have asked me is, how is it going to affect, how this development is going to affect the South Asian region as such, right? If I'm not wrong, India and its neighbor. Okay. Now, you know, sir, sure, for sure, you know, the developments in the recent past, I mean, like just few months, not only in Afghanistan, you know, but also in South Africa and the rise of Boko Haram and the post-arrest of Jacob Zuma. I mean, definitely it has a very strong effect on the strategic environment of India. I mean, I think it's high time that we need to quickly have a retrospect on our foreign policies and strategies. But before answering to your question about these so-called development, let's just first look into the position where India actually stands in the entire Afghan crisis or so-called Afghan question. You have said very clearly, I mean, like if one knows the geographical location of Afghanistan, it's very clear that it's Pakistan, it's Uzbekistan, it's Kazakhstan, it's Turkmenistan, it's so, you know, as a landlocked country, Afghanistan shares porous border with all these so-called, you know, neighboring states. With India, roughly we have around 100 kilometers of area, that too with Pakistan, in Pakistan occupied Kashmir. 75 years on, we are not even, it's still a matter, an unresolved issue, you know. So looking into the geopolitical location of Afghanistan, till 2001, India's involvement in Afghanistan was very limited. The scope, and the possibility by which India could have played played an important role in the region or in the country was restricted practically due to this geopolitical location. Point number two. We know, we are aware that from 1996 to 2001, I mean, like this span of time when Taliban was controlling Afghanistan, we had Operation Parakram, we had the parliamentary attack, we had Kargil, there were a lot of cross-border terrorist movements, terrorist state-sponsored and non-state terrorist groups were having safe haven in Afghanistan and were provided a lot of securities and protections. They were being basically trained. These are well documented. So India made it very clear, or even Kandahar, the hijack. So India was very clear about the fact that it has always branded Taliban as a terrorist organization in almost all public forums, you know. And they have only recognized the elected regimes in Afghanistan, that too after 2001. That is second. Number three is, it's only in the last 20 years. 20 years bhi zyada. If I just cut it short to last 10 years, you know, we have been seeing India to project and locate itself as a very important player in the region. This is specifically due to the persuasion of United States of America. Why? See, United States of America was successful, both Obama and Trump and Biden, they were successful in initiating and pursuing India to initiate some developmental projects so that democracy could be stalled in Afghanistan, like the new parliamentary building, Salma Dam, there is this road which connects the Salma Dam. I'm not get some highway, Sunmark Highway. So that highway, okay. And not only this factors, but even India has also helped Afghanistan in buying certain military equipments also. The Mi-35 helicopters, which was financed by India and was gifted to Afghanistan in 2015 when Modi went to Afghanistan. So, you know, it's only in the past two decades, India has tried to cultivate its relation with Afghanistan and played an important player in the land. So, the questions which usually comes to all of us, that what role will India play and whether the incoming of Taliban is going to affect India or not, I think honestly we have a very limited role to play in it. But saying so, there are few things which can't be compromised. Number one is the Chabahar port. You know, India thought that this Chabahar port will be a best possible way out by which it could actually, you know, bypass Gwadar and you know, it can initiate trade route via this port or the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline. Or say cultivating friendly democratic values in Afghanistan in order to make sure that radical elements does not find safe haven in Afghanistan. You know, these are something which India needs to rethink seriously about right now, because these are at stake. Due to this unplanned withdrawal, we are really at a jeopardy that what is going to be the status, what is going to be the, I mean, like the position of so-called 3 million investment which India did. How the anti-Indian state or non-state sponsored terrorist groups like Jaish-e-Mohammed, and there's also speculation that IS might come up. How India is going to retain, how India is going to protect its border from the influx of these terrorists. How India is going to retain this strategic establishment, how India is going to make sure that its movement in Afghanistan or its so-called, you know, a lot of investment and contribution at least does not goes in vain. So these are primarily the two factors, and in order to protect it, and in order to, you know, take care of these factors, India's options are very limited. I would say they're rather limited to just three. One, India can, you know, initiate backdoor diplomatic channels with Taliban. I mean, like, with the use of the back, because publicly India has made it very clear that Talibans are terrorists. So, and India is never going to negotiate with any terrorist outfit. That's very clear. We never did. You know? So, backdoor diplomatic channels and trying to get in connection with Taliban is one possible outway. But I don't know how long this is going to work, because Pakistan is a major player in that region, and Pakistan's influence in Afghanistan is way more stronger than India's influence over Taliban. Point number two, or the second option, can be that if India can align itself with, you know, the players in the region, which we were just talking about, Iran, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, you know, and try to find out a strong place, or at least find sideline mechanism through which it can act or be part of the peace process, peace talk, and negotiate with the Taliban, so that at least its national interest national security, secured borders are being maintained. And the last and the only possible way, I also believe, I believe is if India can basically initiate a process of sponsoring and supporting the anti-Taliban wing, the Northern Alliance, the Tajik, which I was just mentioning, Ahmed Massoud and others. But be whatever, India need to adopt a policy of cautious optimism, you know, because dispassionately, if you try to understand, if you try to analyze, India have a very limited scope to play with Afghanistan, you know, because China had made it very clear that it's not going to be a mute spectator, not going to be a silent player in the game. There are two narratives which is right now going on. One is saying that the end game is there, and another narrative is saying that the civil war is supposed to come out. But whatever be the situation, China has made it very clear that I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to be a silent player in the game. It's because of the minerals, and it's also because that China want to use Taliban and ban the East Turkmenistan Islamic movements, which it blames is basically the reason why there is an unrest in Muslim-dominated Xinjiang province of China. And obviously, as I've mentioned, Pakistan is a major player in the region. Pakistan will never want that India will that Taliban can garner or can create a better relationship, a cordial relationship with India. It's actually against its national interest. So I think it's high time they will think that we should settle our scores. US is out. The only sole player who can actually act as a stabilizer in the region is Pakistan. And Pakistan will look multiple opportunity to explore the land, you know, providing safe haven for the terrorist outfits so that its national interest, economic interest is met. Because please understand practically, who is after US, who is going to control, or if after US, the world community needs to implement any plan, policy, stability in Afghanistan, they have to do it via Pakistan. Recently, in one of an interview, the Pakistani Prime Minister, he said that, you know, we have always been backstabbed by Americans. Americans came back in the Soviet for containment. They said it's a matter of week, but they stayed back. Then again, after 9/11, they said it's a matter of week, they stayed back, and we suffered. So basically, they're hinting that we are ready again to serve your interests. All we need is to be in the good books of American diplomacy. That's what they're doing. And India obviously needs to be very cautious about its approach. Yes.
China has considerable economic interest, stakes, economic stakes for investment, etc. China has the problem with the Uyghur Muslims. Russia has the problem with Chechen mm-hmm. People. And if they pamper the Taliban, don't you think that it will create some problem for themselves as well? Because the Taliban are, at least it is alleged that the Taliban have support for the Chechens and the Xinjiang, they're the Uyghur Muslims. But still we find that Russia and China, they are extending their support for Taliban. But India cannot live alone. So do you think that India should think about reducing her too much dependence on USA. India has become very close to USA during this period, recent period. Once it was, she was very close to Soviet Union, but now she is very close to United States. But this may cost her. For which reason, India should make a policy of maintaining a kind of equilibrium, kind of balance in this region. And for that reason, she must be careful about not worsening her relations with Russia and China. So I don't know what will be the way out. What do you think?
You know, sorry to interrupt. I mean, you know, in international relations, there are never permanent allies, not their permanent enemies. So what we have in international, what we have studied is that there are always shared common interests, which actually create, you know, blocks, which actually create, you know, different groups in the international system. Answering to your question that, you know, yes, if Taliban, can they be a sympathizers of this so-called fractions in Russia and China? The answer to that is, I believe it's too early to predict it. Why? Because at the moment, the sole questions for the Taliban is somehow to retain and maintain their establishment, the stability of their establishment. But what I can foresee, I'm sure scholars of international relations, they would also agree to this one, that what we can foresee is, we can foresee a very dark future of Afghanistan. You know, the ethnic conflicts in the name of Taliban and anti-Taliban movement has already started. Opium trade is going to be the only sole bread earner, you know, the economy, the political economy, which is going to guide, because Talibans are not hardworking. They are not going to consider the reason, you know, why Salma Dam was created, to make sure that the western part of Afghanistan gets irrigation, to uphold the irrigational activities in the western part of Afghanistan. So neither they are going to boost on irrigation, neither they are going to stay on democratic ways of building infrastructure or development. Okay, because at such a volatile environment, who is going to come and invest? So the first sole question right now, Afghanistan is, and I can see a very dark future, a dark future of civil war, a dark future of Hobbesian state of nature. Practically, imagine women are throwing their child out of the barbed wire in the airports because they feel, at least if I die, my child is safe. So what can you expect? I mean, like, forget about the question of the Taliban's helping or supporting their sympathizers in Russia, China. The question is their survival. The question is their survival. Even if they survive, what will be the political economy of the country? Just rest, because at one point of time, your sympathizers will stop. Okay, another thing was that the next question you asked about is whether India should, yes. Now see, I think it will be wrong to make a statement that India is aligned with United States. Why I say it will be wrong is because India is right now has managed itself as a rising power in the nation, in the region. You know, there are a lot of problems. Agree, but I'm not talking about them. Let's look into the way around, that the way India is right now negotiating with the Eastern partners in order to contain China. South, in the South China Sea, the Eastern partners, Eastern countries, is commendable. Is practically commendable. Our foreign secretary, Mr. Shringla, he is visiting to almost all the countries and is basically trying to garner support so that they can create a base out there. You know, recently, India gave BrahMos missile to Philippines. Imagine a missile, a cruise missile, which has the capability to fire from air, water, and land, was given to Philippines. So they are basically, so it's pretty evident enough, and that India is, I mean, like, sure, we do have collaborations with United States and in Quad, in Indo-Pacific, in multiple other areas. But, you know, there are shared values which are bringing us and making us the partners of each other. It's the value of democracy, it's the value of human rights, and that is what is making a shared common platform. However, India suffers with two major problems in it. The first is India's foreign policy is very much reactionary. Rather making an actionary one, it basically is a reactive foreign policy. So China comes up with Belt Road Initiative, which was previously known as Ubud. India suddenly comes and String of Pearl thing. India suddenly comes up with Operation Project Mossam and other things. So, you know, China comes up in South China Sea. India started finding ways in which it can mediate with the Eastern allies and explore the Indian Ocean region, Indo-Pacific region. So I think India should focus right now more and more to turning itself as a manufacturing hub, which other scholars have agreed to it. You know, just by providing as a service provider, India's right now main goal in terms of foreign policy needs to make sure that it can be a trustable partner amongst the smaller South Asian region. India suffers from this trust deficit. Beat Bangladesh, beat Sri Lanka, beat the smaller countries, beat Nepal, beat Maldives. So, you know, that is something which is which India needs to think over it. I'm not talking about the domestic issues. Forget about them. Let's just focus on the foreign policy areas. India definitely has these problems and it needs to be resolved as early as possible.
My last question is, as you have mentioned, the Hobbesian state of nature, the war of all against all, situation, nasty, brutish, solitary, poor,
dark.
In this situation, a lot of people are talking about a possible intervention by the UN Security Council. UN peacekeeping forces had been deployed in many countries in the past, in many difficult situations, in Asia, in Middle East, in Africa. But why not? Why not a similar step is being taken by the UN Security Council? For example, a kind of peacekeeping force or something like that. What do you think about this? That is my last question.
So it's been 20 years that an allied forces was been working out there in protecting Taliban, in defending Taliban against Afghanistan. The US has made it very clear that it's our time is over. It's now the Taliban government who has to protect it. We are seeing genocides. We are seeing a level of genocides happening, humanitarian crisis taking place in Afghanistan, in almost all districts of Afghanistan. But I believe that, I think that, you know, UN intervention is, I mean, like, I might be naive in saying so, or maybe I'll be very much practical in speaking so. But I believe that instability of the country is what some of the major players in the region actually want. Because they want to fetch their benefits out of an unstable Afghanistan. You know, stable Afghanistan is a problem for most of its neighbors, big players in the region. How are you saying so? Since India is right now in one of the most important positions in UNSC, until and unless the P5, I mean, like, obviously, there are certain rules, standard operative protocols which have been followed before UN intervenes in humanitarian support for a nation. You know, I don't think China, neither Russia, is going to come and support, or I'm sure they're going to veto all the thing out and will say that it's not a crisis which needs UN to come up. I'm sure they're going to veto the thing up, and they're going to say that, you know, these are political problems which can be resolved by the leaders in Afghanistan. That is what even they said when the Kashmir crisis was going on, pre-2001. They just said that these are problems of law and order. The greater powers, so-called UN, they say that these are law and order problems. These are maintenance of law and order. And they don't want UN to interfere and intervene, given the ground that the world is being shattered by this, pandemic, economic disaster is there. So logically, if you look into the factor, an unstable Afghanistan is a cause for stability for most of the players in the world, at least in the region. So their national interest, their national objectives will be served if it's an unstable thing. So look into the equation between US and Iran. Okay. Iran and Pakistan, I mean, like, after the Doha talks, when the Tehran talks were initiated, you know, Iran, it was initiated, led by Iran. You know, it's clearly accepted, like Iran brought in Turkey, Pakistan, Tajikistan was also there. Okay, so it's very clear that US has to come to the mediating table if they want stability in Afghanistan. And that can be only done when you can recognize Iran and when you can recognize Pakistan. So, it's very too early to predict these things. But as a scholar of and a reader of international relations, we can only speculate the things that maybe this is what we are going to witness: an acute humanitarian crisis, a state of war situation, a brutal civilization going back to more 50 years, maybe within few, although Taliban is saying that we are not the previous Taliban, we are Taliban 2.0, we are more reformist, we are more secular, we are more liberal, we are more, you know, sympathetic. But I beg to differ with this, and I believe that, I believe that very soon the so-called spirit of democracy, equality, freedom, liberty, you know, that at least the minorities, the women and the Pakistani nationals enjoy at least for a small period of time, it's going to just wither away. With the implementation of Sharia law, India, however, you know, I don't know whether time permits or not. I mean, like, just a small, it just came into my mind when I was talking about ethnic minorities. I mean, one major problem which no one is perhaps talking about, but I think it's very crucial at this moment of time to understand that, you know, what will be the India's position if, you know, the minorities seek refugee in India. While talking about the minorities, this came into my mind. So what if the CAA is implemented? You know, is India going to just bring in a particular sect of religious communities and give them refuge status and citizenship using CAA? What will be the concept of Hazaras? What will be the concept of Tajiks? What will be the concept? What will be the ideas of Uzbek? What will be the future of Baloch? What will be the future of minorities? I mean, like, this is something which I am really looking forward. I mean, I'm sure the entire world and India symbolizing a champion of so-called democracy, human rights, liberty, freedom. This is something, an acid test, which is going to test. I mean, like, what if the refuge comes in? Is India going to retain its CAA status or not? Yeah, I mean,
secularism.
Yes, secularism.
You know, Tanveer, since you are an expert on international relations.
Please don't call me an expert, please.
See.
I'm a student.
When I decided to take your interview on this issue, I am not a person of international relations, so I had to do a lot of homework, considerable homework. And during my studies,
hello,
that, can you hear me?
Hello, sir. Yes, hi. I can hear you. Go ahead. Yes, sir. Yes,
can
sir.
You hear me? Okay. So, I had to do a lot of considerable homework. What I found, you see, very interesting thing. There is one trend. They are saying that American imperialism was a greater danger, and Taliban has an anti-imperialist character. So it is preferable. The other trend of explanation is that many other scholars are saying that America may be imperialist, but America wanted to establish, to restore democratic norms, women's freedom, human rights. These are not negligible, and Talibans are going to destroy it. So Talibans are greater danger for humanity, for Afghan people. These two trends are there. In the middle, today I was studying in the morning a general statement, a long statement made by several human rights organizations. Several human rights organizations of India and also of some other countries. This third position says that reject both American imperialism and Talibani repression. Let us extend our support to the alternative tendency, the democratic Afghans, the human rights activists, the women film directors. You know, recently a film director, she has written written a petition to all the international.
Yes, I received.
I forgot her name, something like Salma or something. Mm-hmm. And these human rights activists, these people, the democratic people, the women, the people who are democratic minded, progressive minded, let us reject both American imperialism and Talibani repression. Let us glorify, let us extend our support to this democratic stream. But this stream is very weak, you know, so we really don't know what will happen. But thank you very much, Tanbir. I think there is a question. There is a question from the audience. I will request Shomo to present the question.
Okay.
Yes, sir. We have a question by Dhananjay Shaha. Dhananjay has asked that, would you please focus on what ought to be done by India when Taliban forms government in Afghanistan, because they are trying to stand by as a barrier of OPEC countries, and what is the future of the relationship of India and the Arab countries?
India and the Arab countries?
Yes, sir.
I think the first question was, what would be the stand of India if Taliban forms a
Government, because they are trying to stand as a barrier.
Okay. I think Dhananjay, thank you for your question. But I think while in the course of discussion, I did answer that India has made it very clear that it is not going to negotiate with Taliban as a terrorist outfit. However, India has always made it very clear that any elected form of government is welcome, and India would always initiate dialogue, will always extend its solidarity with the so-called, with the so-called elected form of governments which are there, and if established in Afghanistan. So that is pretty clear. And if not, India's options, as I've told you, is very limited. Because unlike Pakistan, India is not a major player. Like India is an important player in countries like Bhutan because of its geopolitical location. Similarly, unfortunately, due to its geopolitical location, India has a very limited scope to play. Now, regarding another question is, what is India's position with Arab countries, right? And like how the relation equation... Okay, I can see the question. Just a second. Do you please focus on what ought to be done with India when the Taliban form a government in Afghanistan, because they are trying to stand by as a barrier of OPEC countries, and what is the future of relation between... Okay, now, I think I have able to answer, Dhananjay, the first part of your question. The second part is that what if and what would be the relation between India and its Arab countries? So it's very clear, India has always tried to maintain a diplomatic connection with Arab countries. And I'm sure India right now, because of its limited role to play in the region, is exploring multiple possible attempts so that they can make up at least a sideline talk with the Arab countries, who can play an important role as a negotiator with the Islamic Republic, Emirates of Afghanistan, if formed by Taliban. But we are, it's too early to predict the future, because we don't know if the anti-Talibani forces are capable enough to withstand the rise of Taliban. And what if tomorrow it gets support, this anti-Northern Alliance gets support from countries like US and India through a backdoor medium? What if it's an overthrown? What if it's a democratic government which comes to the... But India, yes. India has always initiated and is always and is presently trying to find out suitable alternative so that it can be a part of this talk process and a negotiator in managing affairs with Taliban. Anything else, Shomu?
No, sir. That is the only question we have.
Yes.
So thank you so much, Tanvir, for giving your time. I'm asking so many questions.
No, I mean, I'm really thankful to you and Shomu, especially PB sir, because I mean, getting an invitation from you, it's not an invitation, rather. You just ordered me that I have to be in your show, and I was there. I don't know whether I did justice or not.
It was not an invitation. It was a prayer.
It was an order. But then I don't know whether I did justice or not, whether I was able to answer the questions or not properly, and whether your audience were happy with the way I responded to the questions. But I tried my best, and I would love to be a part of your show again in the near future. Whenever you invite me, I would love to be a part of it. And thank you, Shomo, for such a wonderful management. You know, it was flawless. I thought that we are going to, my connection is going to freeze, but then you manage the thing so well. Thank you. That's it.
Shomo will say a few things.
Yeah, I have a brief summary of everything that sir said. A lot of points came up during the entire discussion. First of all, the classical realist approach of American foreign policy in Afghanistan and its predictability. The relentless move of USA towards Taliban started from President Obama. The growing cost of war, both economic and political, and the pacifist nature of Biden as another reason of US withdrawal. The absolute incompetence of Afghan army due to lack of governmental support that led to broken morale. US forces kept Taliban in control due to a stabilizing effect. Taliban's terror brought local people in their camp. Taliban and the Afghan ethnic politics. Resistance against Taliban has emerged through the Panjshir. The politics of Taliban and the misinterpretation of Sharia. India's involvement in Afghanistan has increased in the last 10 years in terms of developmental projects and investments. The threat of rising terrorist activities in India and the threat to Indian developmental projects of Afghanistan as a result of the rise of Taliban. Pakistan has greater influence in Afghanistan than India. Possible diplomatic options for India in Afghanistan include backdoor deals with the Taliban or creating diplomatic alliance with other regional powers. Chinese involvement in Afghanistan is economic and political for the purpose of ending resistance in the Xinjiang province. The possibility of Afghan economies complete dependence on opium trade as a result of the incoming of the Taliban. India's need to get rid of a reactionary foreign policy and management of its trust deficit in the region. An unstable Afghanistan serves the interests of the major powers in the region. And finally, concerns regarding India's approach to Afghan minorities. So these were the few basic points.
Yes. I think you brilliantly jotted a few things. I had no idea that these were being written by you. But then thank you so much. Yeah. These are primarily the areas which I talked.
Yes, sir.
So I don't know whether I was able to do justice or not. Anyways.
So it was a great discussion, and we are incredibly thankful that you joined us today. And to everyone,
it was an honor for me. Thank you, Shomo.
Thank you, sir. And we are also thankful to everyone who watched the session today. And we will be updating about our next session in a few days. And this video will be uploaded in the eSpartacus YouTube channel as well in the next couple of days. And the ones who couldn't watch it entirely here, they could also watch it there, or they could watch it here as well. No problem about that. So thank you everyone, and good night.
Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
So those who have missed today's program, please wait. Within a few days, this interview will be uploaded in eSpartacus YouTube channel.
And please subscribe to the eSpartacus YouTube channel.
I'm going to do it right away. Hello. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.